ask the questions even when there aren't answers, it allows your comfort to feel positive. Any other responses? Any other things that you know that helped you with your faith or helped you impart faith to your children? So let's have a look today at a few things that I've found to be meaningful in my quest, and hopefully something that you can share, you might find meaningful yourself, and also that you can share with your children, and that I've shared with many students. So Sarah Yimei Tshuva, this period that we're in the midst of right now, is certainly a time of heightened introspection and heightened contemplation about our relationship with God. And when thinking about our religious lives, we often cannot help but entertain doubts that at times arise from the inexplicable and confusing reality that we all experience or minimally observe. And it's difficult to hear about tragic events on a personal or on a national level without questioning divine justice. It's difficult to connect with God without wondering about his ways and his role in our world. So today I'd like to explore with you the tension between faith and doubt from both a biblical and a philosophical perspective. And hopefully this will enhance our understanding and our commitment before Yom Kippur this week. Now this tension is something that I personally grappled with. And it basically started when I was an adolescent. And it really motivated my study and my subsequent teaching of philosophy. James Fowler, who is a very well-known psychologist who wrote a book about spiritual development called Stages of Faith. I actually used it a lot when I wrote my dissertation on the spiritual development of modern Orthodox adolescent girls. And he explains that the adolescent stage of development is very much the time when an individual challenges their preconceived notions and they begin to think more critically about all aspects of their lives, including their religious lives, as they form their identity. So I started this quest when I was an adolescent, and I'm certainly continuing this quest now as an adult, and I've encountered many students in their adolescence who either fear to doubt or, more often, doubt and fear, and I try to respond to my students' challenging questions with a lot of honesty and sensitivity, and by exposing them to some of these texts that I've found personally meaningful, full, and influential. And hopefully you'll find them meaningful and influential as well. If you look with me at the first source on your source sheet, Tehillim Perek Kaf Zayin is recited at the conclusion of Shacharit and Maariv from Rosh Chodesh Elul through Shemini Atzeret. So during this Aseihu Tshuva, during the whole Yamim Noraim period. And this Mizmor, this Perek of Tehillim, expresses the struggles within man's relationship with God. Now the Meshorer, the psalmist, the speaker in this Mizmor, in this Perek of Tehillim, describes the oscillation between faith and doubt that results from man's dialectical awareness of God's presence and God's elusiveness in our lives. And during this period of Aseihu Tshuva, this time of introspection, it's a particularly poignant, honest, and hopeful mizmor, which reflects the natural religious tensions that are experienced by all of humanity. Now, the progression of this mizmor, of Perek Kaf Zayin of Tehillim, reflects the duality of man's stance before God, as the mizmor can be divided into two sections, which differ in both form and substance. The first half of source number one, Psukim Aleph through Vav, evokes a sense of absolute trust in God, a feeling of closeness to Him, and a firm belief unmediated by any doubt. Let's take a look at Psukim Aleph through Vav. The David Hashem Uri V'Yishim Imi'i Ra Hashem Ma'oz Chayai Mimi'echad. God is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? God is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? B'krov alam re'im le'chol b'sari, sarai v'yvai li, heima kashnu v'nafalu. When evildoers come upon me to consume my flesh, even my enemies, they stumbled and fell. Im tachane le'machane, lo yira li'bi, im tekum ala l'chama, v'zot ani boteach. Even if an army should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. If war should rise up against me, even then will I be confident. So the Mishra, the speaker in this Mizmor, then goes on to explain more of this paragraph by describing his korbantota, his Thanksgiving sacrifices to God, accompanied by Shira and Zimra, song and praise that he will offer upon his salvation. So reflecting this conviction, the Meshurah speaks about God in third person with his complete confidence that God will save him with no urgent need to appeal to God directly. However, if you look at the progression of the Mizmor, starting with Pasuk Zayin and the very next Pasuk, we see that man's relationship with God shifts dramatically in the second half of this Mizmor. Starting from Pasuk Zayin to Pasuk Gimel, the Meshurah calls out to God in second person in distress. He calls out to Hashem and he says, Shema Hashem kol yekra v'chaneni v'aneni. No longer feeling that same sense of security that he had felt in the first half, the Meshurah pleads with God in second person, Hear my Lord, my voice as I cry out, be gracious to me and answer me. L'cham bar libi v'kshu v'nai et panecha Hashem ha'kesh. He says, On your behalf my heart has said, Seek my presence. Your presence, Hashem, the Meshurah cries out, do I seek? Al taster panecha mimeni, al tat bafavdecha azratayita, al titsheni v'al tazveni Eloheishi. He says, Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. Do not abandon me. Do not forsake me. These latter verses describing God's anger, his remoteness, and his abandonment of man seem almost antithetical to the former ones which we just read from the first half of the Mizmor, which express God's compassion, his concern, and his salvation. And now, in the second half of the Mizmor, the Meshurah's infinite triumph no longer seems so assured. Now, despite these desperate pleas in the second half of the Mizmor, all hope in God is not lost. And we see, starting in Pasuk Yud, Ki aviv yami azavuni v'hashem yasveini. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but God will gather me in. The Meshurah metaphorically places his trust in God as if he was a helpless and rejected child with no other form of protection. Only God will give him the unconditional love. Horeni Hashem darkech l'chein borot mishor l'man shirarai. He says, Show me your way, Hashem, and lead me on the right path because of them that lie in wait for me. The Lashon here is similar to Moshe's request in Shemot in Perek Lamed Gimel, where he says, Horeni na et kvodecha, vodini na et darkecha. Show me your ways, Hashem. Let me know your essence, which Chazal and the Rambam both interpret as Moshe asking God to reveal himself to him so that he can better understand God and so that he can better help Israel connect with him. If we go on in the Mizmor and Masuk Yibet, he says, Al titneni b'nefer sarai kifimu fiyate sheker fiyafir hamas. Do not deliver me to the desires of my enemies. Masuk Yibet, which is probably the most enigmatic Masuk in this text, the Meshurah maintains a sentence of hope in God, which he articulates in this very cryptic way. He says, Luleya emanti l'ropa tu Hashem l'eret chayim. Had I not believed that I would see the goodness of Hashem in the land of the living, This conditional negative is understood as a positive. The Meshurah is saying here, I do believe that I will see the goodness of God while I'm yet alive, for with this not so, and he leaves the rest open-ended. The Meshurah leaves the statement open-ended for the reader to complete, implying that a conclusion would be inexpressible, would be too horrific for words. In other words, he's saying, were it not for the trust in God and in his goodness, through which he gained the strength to endure, he would have perished. Now, if you look at the conclusion of this Mizmor, the final verse serves as a conclusion not just to the second half of the Mizmor, which expresses man's doubt, but rather it serves as a conclusion to the entire text. And it's distinct from the previous verses in that the Meshurah is no longer talking about himself in first person. He is now appealing to the reader, the listener, to hope in God in both confident and distressful times, as alluded to the Lashon in the repetition of the language. In the last Pasuk, Pasuk Yedalit, the Meshurah concludes, Kaveh Hashem, Chazak v'yameitz v'becha, v'kaveh Hashem. Have hope in God, be strong, and he will give courage to your heart and hope to God. Rashi interprets the omni-significance, or the unique meaning, of each of the repeated phrases of hope to Hashem. Rashi says in source number 2, Kaveh Hashem, v'im lo titkavel tibadcha, chazor v'kaveh. Hope to meaning hope to God in times of confident faith, as described in the first half of Greece 4, and continue to hope to God even in times of doubt, as depicted in the second half. Robert Alter, in source number 3, a very well-known biblical scholar, in his book, The Book of Psalms, comments in the following excerpt. In source number 3, he says, "This last exhortation," meaning the last concluding verse, "whether of a speaker to himself or to an individual member of his audience, is an apt summary of the psychology that informs this psalm. It begins by affirming trust in God and reiterates that hopeful confidence, but the trust is to be asserted against the terrors of being overwhelmed by implacable enemies." Now, Rav Lichtenstein, in an article about Bitachon, distinguishes between two levels of faith, which is quite consistent with both Alter and our interpretation of this mizmor. Rav Lichtenstein, in his article on Bitachon, distinguishes between Bitachon shel emunah and Bitachon shel ahava. If you have a look at 4a, he describes Bitachon shel emunah, faithful trust. He says, "Faithful trust is expressed by the certainty that God stands at your side and will assist you. On the field of battle, the warrior who can adopt this trust feels that he's on the threshold of victory. In moments of crisis, one feels that salvation is on the way. During a night of terrors, this type of trust heralds the break of dawn." He then goes on to describe another type of faith, what he calls Bitachon shel Ahava. In distinction, he says, in B, loving trust is expressed in a steadfast commitment, even if the outcome will be bad. We will remain reliant on and connected to God. This approach does not claim that God will remain at our side. Rather, it asks us to remain at his side. Now, Rav Lichtenstein in this article explains that man's challenge in this world is not to simply have faithful trust, the first type, certain of God's salvation, like the first half of our mizmor, but rather, the challenge is for man to have loving trust, as the mizmor concludes, to remain on God's side even when he doesn't seem to be on ours. Hope to God, and even if your prayers are not fulfilled, go back and hope again. Man's relationship with God often wavers between overwhelming faith when God's presence seems very clear in our lives, and inevitable doubt when experiencing the harsh realities of life that causes one to feel abandoned by God. Man's religious feelings are very complex, as he struggles to maintain a sublime faith in God, in spite, at times, of God's seeming hiddenness, either by crises, by enemies, and sometimes even by our own inclinations. So perhaps the Meshorer, the speaker in our mizmor, is trying to convey, by using the second half of the mizmor following the first half, perhaps the Meshorer is trying to convey that doubt is inevitable in our religious experience. However, such uncertainty need not be consciously avoided. We don't have to rid ourselves of doubt, but those doubts can be sublimated in a constructive manner to even strengthen faith. Doubt causes one to question, and such questions can motivate a quest for greater understanding and even a closer connection with God. Now, many modern theologians recognize the existence of doubt and the important role it plays within religious consciousness. Following the precedent of Rav Soloveitchik and many other noted Jewish philosophers and theologians who were deeply influenced and often quoted their Christian counterparts, let's now have a look at a few sources to see how thinkers of other religions describe the nature of faith. Stephen Davis, in source number 5, a professor of philosophy of religion and Christian thought, writes in his book Faith, Skepticism, and Evidence, he writes the following. He says, "The best kind of religious faith is dynamically involved with doubt. Faith needs a kind of healthy skepticism to be genuine. An absolutely certain faith is a dead faith, a static faith, unable to move forward or improve itself. For it is by means of doubts and questions honestly faced engage in a fierce struggle. Doubt's not an impediment to true faith, but rather a goad that stimulates us and deepens our faith. Doubt, therefore, motivates us to study God's creation, to study God's words, because we need to achieve a greater understanding as a result of our doubt. If you have a look at source number 9, Rabbi Lamb continues. In the cognitive area of faith, doubt may play a positive role, not a frozen doubt, but a liquid doubt, one which melts in the encounter with a phenomenon and is absorbed by it and strengthens it in return. Cognitive faith is not an abstract, static acknowledgement of truth. It's a violent struggle in the attainment of emet. I begin by believing despite doubt. I end by believing all the more firmly because of doubt. Emunah is thus a dialectical process, not an established fact. Faith and doubt are not an essential contradiction to each other. Faith, as Tillich puts this, as we saw earlier, is the continuous tension between itself and doubt within itself. This is, of course, a dangerous and risky kind of faith. This is one of my favorite lines. But you cannot open your mind to truth without risking the entrance of falsehood. And you cannot close your mind to falsehood without risking the exclusion of truth. Now, I mentioned James Fowler, the psychologist at the beginning. And in his discussions of the stages of faith development, he described the significant role of doubt in enabling an individual to introspect, to gain a greater self-understanding that will ultimately bring him closer to God. Fowler adds, however, that in addition to using doubt as a motivation to seek greater understanding, doubt should also make the religious individual appreciate the complexity of truth and the limits of human comprehension. While it's certainly beneficial for doubt to motivate the individual to strive to gain a more profound understanding of God's ways, and much can be understood about God as a result of studying God's creations in our world and as a result of studying God's Torah, but the religious individual must, at the same time, realize that he won't be able to achieve absolute certainty of the divine. And this humble recognition is also a benefit of doubt. Theologians of many religions recognize this value of humility that results from doubt. We have a look at source number 10. M. Holmes Holzhorn, a Christian philosopher who wrote responses to criticisms of religion. He wrote the following.
Jacob Silverstein, please come to Nate's office. Jacob Silverstein, please come to Nate's office.
He says in source number 10, doubt threatens life with meaninglessness. Faith does not remove this threat, but it does give us the courage to take upon ourselves the burden of doubt.
Jamie Harrenstein, please come to Nate's office. Jamie Harrenstein, please come to Nate's office.
And to rejoice in the loss of the certainties to which we had clung with idolatrous tenacity. It delivers us from the folly of pretending that faith gives us knowledge and virtue that transcends the relativities to which human wisdom and goodness are subject. Faith grants us the humility of men who do not and cannot know for certain, who never possess God, but forever need him. R. Lichtenstein similarly iterates man's need to acknowledge spouses. If we have a look at source number 13, Rabbi in a sermon that he gave to the Jewish Center in the 70s, makes this analogy. He says, very few things in life are certain. At best, we can have only a dim and vague perception of things to come. Marriage seems to be one of the most uncertain adventures. To enter into marriage is an act of faith and of awareness of all the risks attendant upon this decision. One who gets married without such an awareness is performing a blind act. One who refuses to marry because he's afraid of the risk and is waiting for a sure thing will likely as not wait forever. Intelligent marriage is an act of faith in a state of high consciousness and alertness, an awareness of the unknown, and yet a willingness to commit oneself because of a higher and deeper feeling, because of an intuition that it's worth the plunge into the Red Sea of problems and pleasure, dangers and delights. Rabbi Lev goes on to explain the analogy. He says this holds true, following the marriage metaphor, for religious life as well. We live in a tempestuous and convulsive age in which we are beset by all kinds of demands, pulls, pressures, and tensions. Pure, absolute, and consistent faith is extremely difficult to come by. At best, our faith waxes and wanes. We experience faith and doubt. But if a person is going to wait until he is 100% sure of every aspect of Judaism, until he understands everything and has no doubts left, he will spend his life in limbo and never achieve the greatness of faith. Religious commitment is, after all, fundamentally an act of faith and willingness to embrace all the risks that commitment entails. Perhaps that is why the contemporary writers often speak of the leap of faith. Those who have been thinking of embarking upon the Jewish adventure must wait until they are spiritually ready, but it must come sooner rather than later, for complete certainty and absolute sureness rarely are achieved in the normal course of life. If anything, they are achieved after the commitment and as an act of faith rather than before it. I've had students in the past ask me why I study philosophy if men can never achieve ultimate truth. And my response has always been to them that I embark on my studies with the knowledge that I won't achieve certainty. But whatever I am able to understand will alleviate some of my doubts and make my commitment that much more meaningful, and will make whatever leap of faith that I have to take smaller and thereby more palatable. Rabbi Lamb offers one last metaphor for such a leap of faith. And he writes this towards the end of his article, Faith and Doubt. He gives the metaphor in source number 14. He says, I see a child drowning, and I discern that there's a chance to save him. Now I may estimate my swimming ability, the child's chance of survival until I reach him, and my chance of saving him, all is very low. Yet the fact that I believe there is some chance of saving him, and that I consider it imminently worthwhile to do so, leads me to my commitment. I jump in and I swim to the child. Now my discernment was plagued with serious doubts and grave misgivings. My commitment, however, was not one bit less total than if I had been a champion lifesaver. I'll spare no effort in achieving success. This is essentially what we have been saying. It's quite understandable and legitimate to entertain doubts about the faith, and yet insulate functional faith from any doubt whatsoever. The act does not, of course, resolve my dilemma, but it does deepen my faith by virtue of my commitment and participation in the performance of a faith act. Life's continuous quest for meaning will almost necessarily lead at times to spiritual anxiety due to doubt. Since often the religious individual fears to doubt, yet doubts in fear, it's important to recognize the Meshorer, our speaker in the Mizmor, his message regarding the inevitability and permissibility, and perhaps even the benefits of confronting the confusions and the anxieties of one's environment. The juxtaposition that we saw between the two halves of the Mizmor depicts this religious tension within man's dialectical relationship with God, since even the most confidently faithful at times experience